حفلنا الكريم، تبدأ الآن الجلسة العامة برئاسة الدكتور منير الدسوقي المشرف على معهد بحوث علم المواد بمدينة الملك عبد العزيز للعلوم والتقنية، ويشارك فيها السير البروفيسور فريزر ستودارت من جامعة نورث ويسترن بالولايات المتحدة الأمريكية، الحائز على جائزة نوبل في الكيمياء لعام 2016، والبروفيسور شوجي ناكامورا من جامعة كاليفورنيا سانتا باربرا في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية، الحائز على جائزة نوبل في الفيزياء لعام 2014، والبروفيسور عمر ياغي من جامعة كاليفورنيا بريكلي في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية، الحائز على جائزة الملك فيصل العالمية في العلوم لعام 2015، والبروفيسور شريف الصفتي من المعهد الوطني لعلوم المواد في اليابان. يتفضل المشاركين إلى المسرح.
Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to open today's session with introducing our first speaker, Professor Fraser Studart. Professor Fraser was born in Edinburgh, Scotland in 1942. His academic career can be traced from many institutions, including Edinburgh University, Northwestern University, Queen's University in Canada, and Sheffield University, and many others. By contributing to the introduction of molecular bond into molecules, he has become one of the few chemists to have opened up an entirely new field of chemistry in which he has pioneered the development of the template-directed protocols for the synthesis of two-state mechanically interlocked molecules, including bistable cadenines and rotaxines, which have made their way into molecule electronic devices. He was made a Knight Bachelor by Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II in her 2007 New Year's Honor List for his service in chemistry and molecular nanotechnology. He is the Fellow of the Royal Society of London, the German Academy of Natural Sciences, and the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences, as well as an Honorary Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh and the Royal Society of Chemistry. His awards include the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for 2016, as well as the King Faisal International Prize in Science, the Albert Einstein World Prize in Science, and the Feynman Prize in Nanotechnology, as well as the COPE Award from the American Chemical Society and the Royal Medal of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. He is a fellow of many institutions, such as the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and a member of the Natural Academy of Sciences. He trained more than 400 graduate and postdoctoral students, of which close to 100 have became successful independent academic career holders. His talk today would be titled "The Design and Synthesis of Non-Equilibrium Systems." Please join me in welcoming Professor Fraser.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your very generous introduction. It is my great honor to be here back in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. This is the first trip that I've taken out of the United States since the announcement of the Nobel Prize in Chemistry that I share with two other people, Jean-Pierre Sauvage from Strasbourg and Ben Ferenga from Groningen in the Netherlands. One point I want to make right at the beginning is that I don't believe I would be standing here today if it were not for the incredible amount of support in every respect that I've received since 2007 from the King Abdul Aziz City for Science and Technology. And I do publicly want to recognize the support that I've had from the now president of CAXT, Prince Turki. His generosity beggars belief. I would like to share with you this morning, in the context of the material that I am trying to put together to take to Stockholm for the first week in December, a story about the nature of the mechanical bond from molecules to machines. The prize, in my estimation, is as much about the invention of a new bond in chemistry as it is about molecular machines at this time. The mechanical bond is relatively new. The mechanical bond is unlike the chemical bond. It is not a bond that brings things together by sharing of electrons. It's a physical bond that overcomes the restrictions between different components. And these different components are most characteristically described as either catenanes or rotaxanes. And you see the very simple definition of those in cartoon form on my next slide. And it is the relationship between the red and blue rings on the one hand, and between the red ring and the dumbbell component that you see on the right, that defines the mechanical bond. I did not come up with the definition. It was effectively introduced into the field of science back in 1953. But just leaving science aside for a minute, one of the great inspirations of my life has been art and culture in every sense. And I just share one of these glimpses with you today, the bringing together of two nations that were at one time, one England, the other Australia, and the English transported their criminals back in the 18th century across the world to Australia. But now you can see with these two interlocked rings that they have become a bond of friendship, a bond of friendship that you can see in Portsmouth in England and in Sydney in Australia. But as in science, there are no firsts in art. You can see there are no firsts in science, there are no firsts in art. And two rings you can see coming together in a sculpture that goes back over 7,000 years to a province in China. So let's go back to the mechanically interlocked molecules that have taken on the names of catenanes and rotaxanes. A rotaxane is a molecule. It's not a super molecule, it is a molecule. Once these components come together, that is the smallest entity that expresses their properties. Wikipedia get it right. I appeal to the scientific community to get it right as well. The term comes from rota, Latin for a wheel, and axis, Latin for an axle. The same is true for catenanes. They are molecular species. And this time the term is deduced from catena, the Latin word for chain. The drive for me to enter this area from the area of so-called host guest and supermolecular chemistry was to move in the direction where the bits and pieces would not be flying apart, but we'd be joined together by this mechanical bond. And I just want to jump forward to 1994, 97, when we synthesized a 5-catenane. This is a catenane composed of 5 rings and therefore conjures up the symbol of the Olympics movement. Now these 5 rings are such that there are 2 red rings that are identical, that are polyether and naphthalene based in character. The other 3 rings, 2 of them are quite small, and they are based on bipyridinium-based entities, and the middle ring is somewhat larger than the 2 on the outside, in order to allow 2 of the red rings to simultaneously thread through that middle ring. Now, what I want to share with you is that, in fundamental terms, there's nothing new here. These rings have been brought together and stay together because of forces that are present, one in DNA, pi-pi stacking interactions, and another in proteins, CH-pi interactions that are rich in aromatic amino acids. And actually, it turns out that in this particular construct, CHO hydrogen bonds are about 80% of the reason why you can bring these five rings together in the first place, and why they interact in a very mutually convenient way with each other. Here is another view in space filling representation. here is finally a 7-catenane in the bottom right hand corner, and these are based on X-ray crystal structures. And one of the reasons that in collaboration with a very fine crystallographer, now retired from Imperial College London, Dr. David Williams, that we went forward and made rings that went up to 5 and 7 and characterized them with great detail, including X-ray crystallography, was that there was considerable amount of misbelief in the community that we were able at the time to interlock these rings. Let me go back again in history, because there are always people who are trailblazers. And one of those trailblazers is a German scientist, still alive today, probably in his late 80s, Gottfried Schill, who in the University of Strasbourg for about 30 years used a form of templation that we call covalent directed synthesis. In other words, he brought two rings together as a result of covalent bonds, which were then subsequently broken. And what I show you here very briefly is the last four steps in a 22-step synthesis of one of the first 2-catenanes that was made just over 50 years ago. My co-laureate, Jean-Pierre Sauvage, should be credited with the massive jump in terms of the bringing together of components. He used templation. He used transition metal templates, in this instance copper, to bring components together that were previously very difficult to bring together under either the covalent directed approach or a statistical approach. Now, here is a slide that will be very difficult for you in the room to even understand because the print is so small. But I do want to point out that the evolution of the mechanical bond has really only started round about 1980 to 1990. This is a new bond in chemistry. And this illustrates the fact that, in my opinion, chemistry is not the oldest of the sciences, it is the youngest of the sciences. And it will remain so because it has this unique property of being able to invent its own materials. It is all about making in the beginning. Making is incredibly important, followed by measuring, followed and often supported by modeling, what I call the three M's. And what you will see on this slide is that most of the activity starts about here. And this is the route that my co-laureate Jean-Pierre Sauvage took, through transition metal templates. We, on the other hand, used both hydrogen bonding and even more so donor-acceptor interactions. And very recently, with support from CAXT, we, in 2010, discovered the power of radical pairing interactions. And it's these radical pairing interactions that have opened up a new way of approaching the construction of molecular machines. History has a habit of repeating itself. When I was an undergraduate student at Edinburgh, we were studying by dynamic NMR spectroscopy, very simple processes like the chair-chair flip of cyclohexane. When we made our first catenane in 1989, it was reported, we were able to use the same technique to follow the circumrotation and pirouetting of two rings with respect to each other in a degenerate molecule. And then in 1991, and I think this is one of the cornerstones in relation to my contribution to the field, that was recognized in Stockholm, we described a molecular shuttle where a ring darts back and forth between two stations, as we called them at the time, in a degenerate setting. How were these compounds made? Let me illustrate it with respect to the molecular shuttle. Very simply, one took this bipyridinium or dicationic species and formed two carbon-nitrogen bonds in the presence of this template. And in the first time we did the experiment, we received a healthy 32% yield in one step of a so-called template directed synthesis. But let me effectively take you into the world of graphical representations to hammer home the fundamental importance of this method of synthesis of mechanically interlocked molecules. And I ask you please to note the elegant interplay. And when I say elegant, we didn't realize when we did the experiments how elegant it was. The experiments told us about the elegance, the interplay between covalent, non-covalent, and mechanical bond formation. So you start off with these light blue components and this template, and they don't talk to each other, they don't interact. You form one carbon-nitrogen bond, and you have a bipyridinium unit here, which wants to interact, since this is pi electron deficient, and these are pi electron rich, with the pi electron rich red unit. So what does it do? It makes its way in between those, and I use these vertical lines to indicate the non-covalent bonding interactions that I've already mentioned that are important in bringing the components together. We haven't made the mechanical bond, but now it is downhill because we thus form another carbon-nitrogen bond and we've now got the rotaxane. But look, the excitement didn't stop there, and when we realized that these interactions that we had built up during the synthesis live on in the molecule, then we realized that we had the basis for amolecular nanotechnology. Before we go to that point and introduce you to switches, I just want to point out, with the chemical structures in front of you, that this blue ring darts back and forth between these degenerate hydroquinone rings at a rate of about 1,000 times a second at room temperature. Here is a movie that I hope encapsulates, both for the rotaxane and for the catenane, where two processes are occurring simultaneously, how these changes are taking place all the time at room temperature and above and below. They are just their rates dependent on the temperature. History has a habit of repeating itself a second time. So again, when I was at Edinburgh as an undergraduate student, we learned that if you put one simple substituent, say a chlorine atom, on a cyclohexane ring, you reduced its symmetry to a point where you could talk about an equatorial and an axial conformation. Now, if we replace one of the red units by a green unit, we can see that we now have the basis for a switch. And this switch can be expressed in a catenane environment or in a rotaxane environment. And now we can talk about translational isomers because these are no longer degenerate, they are isomeric. And we have systems where the ring prefers to be 90% of the time on the green unit and 10% of the time, roughly, on the red unit. Again, I show you a movie that illustrates these non-degenerate MIMS, where you'll see the ring is sitting more of the time on the green unit than on the red unit. So you're asking, what is the green unit? And here I go very fast forward. Fast forward to the end of a period at UCLA, where I had the great good fortune to collaborate with Professor Jim Heath, now at Caltech. And you'll see that this green unit is a tetrathiophulvalene unit, the red unit, the deoxynaphthalene unit, and then this particular rotaxane, which is also amphiphilic. Amphiphilic because we used a technique called Langmuir blotchitry to introduce a lot of these molecules into a crossbar architecture, and the smallest crossbar architecture that we got down to was based on wires that were 17 nanometers in their width. And these two wires, the bottom wires which run horizontally and those that run vertically, are such that they overlap, and at the overlapping point there's roughly 100 molecules trapped in this memory device. The memory device, which is shown up here, is effectively no bigger than the cross-section of a red blood cell. And so we have, because of the 400 times 400 wires, a 160 kilobit molecular memory that we were able to describe back in 2007 in Nature. So the timeline for putting these switches into a molecular electronic device context is shown here. I concentrated for a second on this particular expression of the molecular memory. There was an earlier one based on the similar catenane with the tetrathiophulvilene unit and the dioxynaphthalene unit. And then subsequently, when Professor Omiyagi, who's in the audience, came to UCLA, we started to look at mounting these switches in metal organic frameworks. And the reason for this was, even though we were able to demonstrate using the techniques that we developed with Jim Heath, molecular memory, the molecules were not robust enough to undergo more than 100 cycles, and that was never going to be useful in an applied context. And so we started the search together with Omar to establish a more robust setting. We called it robust dynamics to house our molecularly interlocked molecules within his metal organic frameworks. And more recently at Northwestern, in a collaboration with Joe Harp and Omar Farah, we have used their NU1000 metal organic framework, which has nodes that allow you to solvent assisted ligand incorporation, i.e. SALI, to introduce organic components into the orifices of this particular moth. And here you see a calculated display of this switchable catenane inside the pore of NU1000. And what we can do is get, of course, plenty of experimental evidence, and here's just one piece of evidence from nitrogen uptake, that we have, in fact, been able to sally this micro switch inside a molecular organic framework. The switch switches just as well with the appendage on it that it has to have to be incorporated into the framework as the neutral, as the original 2-catenane. And what is more, when we follow by various techniques on a solid powder between quartz slide, the switching from here to there, and this could be the off state of the switch, and this the on state of the switch, you can see that we can go from the salid catenane component, this dark green absorption here, to this red one, and then back again on reduction. And so here you see the basis, one of the pieces of experimental evidence for the switch. And I am very keen on, when I'm giving my presentation to you and in Stockholm, of actually talking about work that is happening now. This paper will be published this week online in the Journal of the American Chemical Society. Another development while I was at UCLA was collaboratively with Jeff Zink, where we introduced our rotaxane-based switches onto the surface of mesoporous silicon nanoparticles as a basis for drug delivery systems, using both nanovalves, which are shown on the right here, the left, sorry, where the switching of a particular ring back and forth allows either the encapsulation of the drug or the release of the drug. And a snap top is a variant thereof, where the stopper is actually released from the machinery on the outside, giving another means of delivery of drug. Okay, so much about molecular switches. I want to put to you that one of the grandest challenges today is to go from switches to machines. And the difference, in a nutshell, is that machines need to perform work on their immediate environment. Switches, you go from on to off, you go from off to on, you do not do any work. Artificial molecular switches, if we're very honest about it now, are a dime a dozen or 10 a penny. By contrast, artificial molecular machines, which were cited by Stockholm for the Nobel Prize, are still few and far between. And so assembling these entities in a highly interactive way in a robust architectural domain, I would say, heralds a potential game changer for chemical synthesis and a defining moment for molecular nanotechnology. And why should we want to do this sort of science? Well, it takes us into a new realm. As a chemist, I was trained in thermodynamics to think in terms of equilibria and kinetics. The time has now come for us to think in terms of moving away from equilibrium to non-equilibrium processes. And that's what I want to spend the rest of my time talking about, is the construction in recent years of an artificial molecular pump at Northwestern University, and asking ourselves, how do we design systems that operate repetitively and progressively far from equilibrium? That's one of the big questions. Another is, what are the consequences of dissipation on materials properties? And over here on the right, I try to express what these consequences might be. If we have rings that are on polymers, and these rings can move around, then we are going to enter into a new phase of matter. And already some development work has been done in this area using cyclodextrins and very simple polymers like polyethylene glycol in Japan. Okay, so back to some fundamentals. How do we go about designing artificial molecular machines? We can, of course, be inspired by the machines of the macroscopic world, and that's where it all started for me on a farm in Scotland, when the very simple machines started to break upon the scene in the 50s. I was privileged to go from the horse and cart to the combine harvester in my time on a Scottish farm. Anyway, back to, if you're a physicist, then and you're looking at a macroscopic situation, if we want to move this entity, it could be a car or a bicycle, from here over to here, then we have to climb up this mountain, into this valley, up this mountain, and into the other valley over here. This is not the way that our machines work inside our body, or the machines that we are going to construct that are artificial. Here we have to look at a chemical approach where we juggle about with the energy well levels and the transition state levels in a manner that allows us to take a collection of molecules from here over to there. So it's very different because the macroscopic world is not, of course, having to deal with the whole business of Brownian motion and so on. The nanoscopic world is going to be determined by these kinds of phenomena. And so, taking inspiration from nature, bacteria rhodopsin is a protein with these helical polypeptides that allows protons to be pumped in a unidirectional manner from outside to inside a cell. And this happens by juggling about with the energy levels of the wells and of the transition states. And so we asked ourselves just a few years ago, published in 2013, could we imitate this particular type of activity in nature with a very simple situation where we have a dumbbell with a recognition site, the red one, a green barrier here, and a Coulombic barrier over here. So there's one positive charge there. And the ring system that you've seen before is the one that we're going to introduce to this dumbbell component. And it transpires that we can show through a sequence of reduction and oxidation that we can bring it on from the left-hand side and push it off from the right-hand side. And the little change here in this cartoon that I'm going to show you is an effort to show how this can happen, namely that the rings approach, and instead of coming on from the positive side because of Coulombic repulsion, they come on from the left-hand side from the neutral end. And they do this by going over the lower valley, the lower transition state, the lower mountain, into this valley here. And then once you carry out a reduction, you reduce the amount of positive charge and you lower the barrier to it, leaving by the right-hand side. And so you have a way by which you can bring about directional motion. So this is the first thing that we had to achieve, unidirectional motion, coming on from the left-hand side and leaving from the right-hand side. Well, this is fine, but all the time you've got to be self-critical, and I must emphasize that progress in research is very slow. One thing I want to make a point today is that to get anywhere, I think, in life and in science, I'm a great believer in Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hours. It equates to 10 years. 10 years to get to a point where you are a professional and proficient at what you do. In my case, it was a lot slower. It took 20 years. Miracles don't happen overnight. Okay, so the next thing that we took up was to use the radical chemistry that had been put in the literature in the last century by these very eminent scientists I mentioned down here. And this was work that was initiated by Ali Trabolsi from Lebanon. He was trained in Strasbourg, and while he was in my lab, he was the person, I should say, not a synthetic chemist, a physical chemist. He was the person who dared to go and actually, in a reducing environment, namely a self-made glove box, inert environment, show that he could use these radicals in a way that stunned us at the time. Because what he did show, and this was at the time described by one of my ex-postdocs at UCLA as an intellectually disruptive discovery, he could show that methyl violation. When reduced alongside the so-called blue box, produced a very strong complex thanks to radical pairing. And this radical pairing can be followed by titration calorimetry, and you can get values for its complexation strength. It's every bit as strong as the donor-acceptor complexes that we had been studying for decades. An X-ray crystal structure showed that not only that you get a very strong one-to-one complex, but you also get complexation that occurs in a supramolecular way in the crystal with the stacking of these one-to-one complexes in an infinite stack. And so this gave us an opportunity now to introduce a lot of potential energy into our molecular machinery, because if we use radical chemistry to bring together six positive charges, we go down to three positive charges and three radicals, and this gives us a very stable, over 6 kilocalories per mole of binding. Then when we oxidize, we can get back all of this in a very forceful way as we create this Coulombic repulsion. And so we now envisage a situation where I turn the dumbbell round through 180 degrees, and the neutral part of the dumbbell is on the right-hand side, and the charged part is on the left-hand side. And we now use our recently discovered, thanks to Ali Trabolsi, radical chemistry to bring the ring on from the left-hand side and push it off from the right-hand side with gusto, because now we've got a lot of positive charge pushing the ring off the dumbbell. And so this led, going fast forward to 2015, to the design of an artificial molecular pump, where instead of just letting the ring go off into solution, we provided a collecting chain for the rings to be collected, unable to leave because of a large stopper on the right-hand side. The other parts to this design were a steric barrier here, the green entity, which allows the ring, having been brought on under reduction conditions, to sit here until thermal energy manages to get over what we sometimes call a speed bump onto the collecting chain here. Now, I have a movie which takes a little bit of time. I do apologize. If I'm using too much time, tell me. But here we have the ring. We've reduced, and so it can come over easily. It forms a very strong complex. And then we oxidize, and the Coulombic forces raises this barrier hugely, and it pushes it away from this positive charge to the neutral. It sits here under the influence of thermal energy for some time, and then makes its way down here. And this is repeated. We'll just watch it a second time. So now we're going to reduce. We're going to bring down the height of this barrier. This allows the ring to come onto the dumbbell. This one wants to come back, of course, but it can't because of the green speed bump here. And then finally, we go through the same process again. I can't emphasize just how much intellectual effort and the zillions of experiments that went in to this design. This was not easy. This was morning, noon, and night for the researchers involved. And to put it in a nutshell, here we have it in cartoon form, showing the collection of the ring systems. And why did it take so long? Because we had to decide what the long chain would be. More so, we had to decide the nature of this linker here. And eventually, it came down to it had to be two methylene groups. And the steric barrier, that went through 50 or 60 different trials of different steric barriers until we settled on this isopropyl phenyl-based one. And again, the number of units in here was also important. I'm going to come back to this point. And so here is the chemical constitution of the first molecular pump that works rather well. And we can show by dynamic NMR spectroscopy, and I'm not going to go through the detail here. I'm just going to point out very simply that we can get two rings to go to the right. And these rings are indicated by very high field signals here for the methylene protons that are residing in this chain when they are encircled by aromatic units associated with the cyclophane. And what was a very encouraging observation was that not only was the pumping of the rings very efficient, 90%, but also the influence of having one ring on already was not any way significant compared to putting a second ring on. And this is shown by the fact that the barrier that has to be overcome here at the speed bump, the 23 kilocalories per mole, is identical with an experimental error with the second one coming on. So I make the point, one ring on does not discourage the coming on of a second ring. And we could use our NMR technique to show that the first ring comes on and sits round about methylene group 11, so in this region here, and not surprisingly, when the second one comes on, the first ring has to move up here, and the second one comes on round about there. So here's another movie just to show that under reduction conditions, when it's purple, the ring comes on, and then it hesitates to go over the green speed bump, using thermal energy to get there. And so that's how we get two of these rings on. Another movie just showing you the way that one juggles around with transition states and energy wells in order to bring on one. And notice when we reduce, we bring down the barrier. We have a much larger energy well, which we can then, on oxidation, raise to great heights and force the rings over to the right-hand side. And this is what we're very much engaged in today in the laboratory, with lots of, I have to say, generous support from CAXT. So each cyclic ring, or each cycle of the redox process traps one ring in a high energy state. And some, therefore, of the energy in the system is being trapped. And hip, hip, hooray, work is finally being done. We are pumping these rings in a repetitive and sequential way, such that we end up with producing a system away from equilibrium. So why should this be important at the end of the day? Well, we believe that if we can make polyrotaxanes, as I've hinted already, with ring systems that are on the polymers and they don't want to be there, they're very unhappy, then we will have entropically dominated polyrhetaxanes. And the prospect for these, I say, and it's only a prospect in a materials context, is actually quite high. And here I'm just showing you, and this is beyond what we've achieved experimentally, a movie that, again, encapsulates how we bring the rings on to the polymer chains using the redox chemistry, namely reduction followed by oxidation. The last thing that I want to mention is that the process so far has been slow. And so what we are working on now is it's speeding up. How do we enhance the performance? And to do this, we have to increase the repulsion and bring about faster kinetics. And this has been achieved by just taking out one of the methylene groups here. It is so sensitive to change. And again, I have to emphasize that it takes a long time to work all these subtleties out. And if you do this, then the new pump that we have working at room temperature is as efficient as the old pump was at higher than room temperature. And if we go to higher than room temperature, then what we do find is that we can reduce the amount of time it takes to actually 10 minutes as a result of lowering this barrier here to pump rings onto these chains. And so, again, I'm not going to go through the kinetics, just mention that we have worked hard to get the kinetics to be much faster than they were. And finally, we don't want to use chemicals to do the pumping, we want to use electricity. And so we have designed a chronocoulometric pumping system that allows us in a setup of this type, and with the eye of faith, and it's probably difficult to see, this goes purple at one point, showing that the rings are coming on, and during the reduction process, and then they are being taken off here, and the purple goes away. And again, we have the opportunity to increase the nature and constitution of the collecting chain. And we're working on chains with, again, positive charges in them so that a positively charged ring will be even unhappier than it would be on a neutral chain. So I know that this is quite demanding in terms of understanding, but let me just summarize that the key factors in designing this non-equilibrium system have been the interplay between highly stabilizing radical-radical interactions involving bipyridinium units and these bipyridinium-based rings. And when they are reduced, it is the radical interactions that dominate. When they are oxidized, they become strongly destabilizing because of Coulombic repulsions. And it is the interplay between these two worlds that allows us to orchestrate the kinetics and association and dissociation. They can be modulated at will. And what I really want to emphasize today is, again, this is not something that's happened in a year or two. This has taken 20 years. We started probably 25 in the mid-80s. The bistable MIMS that I talked about at the very beginning, the molecular shuttle came on the scene in 1991. And going fast forward, it was, and slow progress, of course, in the interim, it was 2013 before we had the radical chemistry to help us go to this part of the quadrant here with unidirectional transport. And then getting these energetically demanding transports into a situation where we have a basis for a molecular pump that is now being looked at in terms of collecting chains that are large enough to take many of these rings. Finally, a comment about the mechanical bond. You can see, and this emphasizes the fact, that really there was little happening by 1990. And I come back to my point, chemistry is one of the youngest sciences that is out there. Get rid of the idea that this is an old science. It has the ability to reinvent itself by the day. And what you see, interestingly, is that catenanes dominated the field through this very long period of introduction. And then as it takes off, you can see there are taxanes taking over, probably because one gets more motion out of a ring versus a dumbbell than one does through two rings circumrotating with respect to each other. Of course, cytations follow the activity in the field. And cytations, of course, are no different from in any other field. There are some very, very hot papers up here and less hot papers as we go around clockwise. Where is it happening on the globe? Well, of course, in the United States of America, in my own native United Kingdom, in Japan, and China is catching up quickly. Europe is on the scene. I challenge Saudi Arabia to come more and more into this wonderful land of mechanically interlocked molecules. And if you want to join in this fun, then probably tomorrow or the day after it, there will be published by Wiley a book on the nature of the mechanical bond that I have been working on for about 3 years with a stellar ex-graduate student, Carson Bruins, presently a Miller Research Fellow at Berkeley. And it's a 6-chapter book. The introduction is basically written for the layman. There are 2 chapters that follow that describe the making, the synthesis. And then there's a chapter on essentially chemical topology. Maybe I should mention that I think a missed opportunity on the part of Stockholm was not to play up the chemical topology in the chemistry prize with the topology that they mentioned very much in the physics prize this year. Then there's a very important chapter on stereochemistry. The mechanical bond has revolutionized stereochemistry. The subject was almost dying. Now it is reinvigorated as a result of the mechanical bond. And the final chapter is on switches and machines. And there is a young Carson Bruins, absolutely brilliant. An amazing future ahead of him. And finally, I just want to thank, by having a few faces on the right-hand side, a number of people that is as high as 400 or 500 who have contributed, along with many funding agencies, and most significantly of all, the King Abdul City for Science and Technology these past 7 years. They celebrated at CAGST Science and Technology Week in Riyadh a few weeks ago. And you see here Prince Turki at the opening ceremony. You also see here the displays that were taking place at that occasion. And I've not had time today to talk about many of the other things that are going on my lab. The invention of CD MOFs, which has given rise to a startup company called Panacea Nano, which again is being supported by Technia and the King Abdul Aziz City of Science and Technology. And I think up here you see Prince Turki speaking with my co-director, Majid Nizar. And Amit, I am so fortunate to have all this support. At this very moment, there are 4 researchers from the King Abdul City of Science and Technology in my lab. You can imagine just how excited they have been in these past few weeks, jumping up and down with joy. They are with us for 3 months. It would be so much better if they were with us for 3 years, because as Malcolm Gladwell points out, you need 10,000 hours to turn yourself into a real professional. And almost finally, a big tribute to a great co-director. It is a tremendous pleasure to work seamlessly across the waves of the internet with Dr. Majid Nizar, not just in CAXT. And then finally, to thank Dr. Turkey for his great support of our work. Thank you.
I think we have time for maximum two questions, so I'll open the floor.
Between the molecule bonding, is it electrical or what?
Okay, the mechanical bond, as I said in my lecture, is first and foremost a physical bond. It should not be confused or associated with a chemical bond where one has, in some shape or form, the sharing of electrons. It is a physical bond. Within that physical bond, you have the opportunity to create fairly strong non-covalent bonds or coordinated bonds. And so Jean-Pierre Sauvage was the first person in 1983 to realize the power of the coordinated bond to bring what became the mechanical components together. Now, if he removes this transition metal, then there's very little, if anything, force-wise left between the components. Maybe some van der Waals interactions. The interactions that we have used, namely donor-acceptor interactions in the beginning, they can be modulated too as a result of redox properties. And that has been the basis for our switches. The radicals, of course, have introduced another very much stronger type of, if you like, chemical bond within the mechanical bond. So how can I put this? There's a supramolecular world in the language of Jean-Marie Lane that we use in order to make the mechanical bond, and we can choose whether that supramolecular world lives on inside the mechanically interlocked molecule, or we wipe it out completely. So, you know, we have a wonderful world to play around in, a wonderful world of different forms of bonding. And the thing for me that is very exciting is it's within a molecular context. You don't have to worry about the bits flying apart. You've tied them together because of the mechanical bond.
Our second speaker for today's session is Professor Suji Nakamura. He obtained his bachelor's, MS, and PhD degrees in electrical engineering from the University of Tokushima, Japan in 1977, 79, and 94, respectively. He joined Nichia Chemical Industries in 1979, and in 1993 and 1995, he developed the first group 3 nitride-based high-brightness blue and green LEDs. He also developed the first group 3 nitride-based violet laser diodes in 1995. Since 2000, he has been a professor of material and electrical and computer engineering at the University of California, Santa Barbara. He is also the 2014 Nobel laureate in physics for the invention of the efficient blue light-emitting LEDs and enabled bright white bright light energy saving
sources. Please join me in welcoming Professor Nakamura.